Every new blend borrows from the past, and the Saga Blend No. 7 is the perfect combination of timeless knowledge of traditional tobaccos and the newer balance that today's cigar enthusiasts come to expect and love in a fine cigar. Leveraging six generations of experiences and traditions of the Reyes family, the Saga Blend No. 7 delivers a unique, full-flavored, medium-bodied cigar. The cigar is highlighted by a Brazilian wrapper over a blend of Central American and Dominican tobacco. Available in three sizes at an affordable price, the Saga Blend No. 7 is sure to please and bring together past and present. Rocky Patel Premium Cigars. The sun-grown Maduro is hand-rolled at Rocky Patel's boutique factory in Esteli, Nicaragua. This triple-capped, hand-bunched, and hand-rolled cigar is accompanied by a gorgeous broadleaf wrapper. Well-balanced, rich, and decadent, it truly is a great addition to any humidor and worthy of the long-respected sun-grown name. For more information, visit them on the web at rockypatel.com and be sure to follow Rocky Patel Premium Cigars on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.
On something, we don't want there to be any guesswork. We believe the information must be accurate and it has to be reliable. For what we review, the goal is hopefully to educate our audience, and at the same time, an equally important goal is in turn to get educated ourselves. What we want to do is earn the trust of our audience, and to do that, we ensure what we report is accurate, rumor-free, and teaser-free. The premium cigar industry is so dynamic, and every day brings something new. We wanted Cigar-Coop to be an extension of that experience, so it has to be 365 days a year. We wanted to create a true media ecosystem and integrate Cigar-Coop with the power of our Stogie Geeks programming network.
Live from the Villiger North America studios, here in Warwick, Rhode Island, G-Unit Studios, I'm your host for episode 218, Joe Hozempa. We have Mr. Will Cooper, and we have Mark Anderton.
Yeah, how you doing, Joe?
Good. We're talking about the Stogies of the week.
Hey, Will, how you doing?
Hey, Mark, how's it going today?
Doing great, doing great.
You got to be more relaxed right now, considering, Mark is part of our extraordinary production team. These guys do an incredible job. They've had a rough day.
They did. Disclosure, Will, I did offer him this seat for the break, and he said no.
Yeah, I declined.
Because he has work tomorrow. I says, well, you can have it, but...
I endorse it, but yeah.
Next week, I'll be sitting on the co-host's chair, and hopefully Paul will be back in studio. Thank you for joining us. This is the Stogies of the Week segment here. We post our reviews on StogieGeeks.com. Check them out under the Stogies section. And Will also has his website. Will, why don't you give that out as well in case we get some new listeners? You got a new co-host. So statistically proven, you might have new listeners.
Yes. Yep, that's true. www.cigar-coop.com. So be sure, it's a 365-day-a-year website.
Check it out.
Very nice.
Check it out. Stogies of the Week. Will, why don't you go for it?
All right. So I alluded to this one at the start of when we were going through the top 25. And I smoked a cigar called the Neanderthal. Have you had the Neanderthal at all?
No.
Okay. So the Neanderthal is a full strength, full body, full flavored powerhouse. And it was released probably a couple of years ago. And the idea what they did with this cigar, and I think they was a lot of times when Skip Martin was talking about how you have strong cigars, they sometimes do lose something. So he wanted something that was going to be that keep that punch and strains. And he did that with Neanderthal very successfully. This is not a cigar for the faint at heart. It's a strong cigar. And I smoked a size called the SGP, which stands for shallow gene pool. So it's kind of tying in with the editor. Yeah, yeah. It's a 4.5 by 52 petite Robusto. I've smoked the HN, which is more of a Figurado type of shape on it. But this cigar is like I said, it's going to keep its strength. It's a strong cigar. It's a little powerhouse. It's going to have great notes of mocha, earth. It's got a red pepper. That mocha and red pepper kind of play off each other really, really well. It's the same thing. It's got a tobacco taste to it, so it's not like dessert on this thing. It's, again, full That's strength, full full body. Thing burns like a champ. I mean, this SGP, this Petit Robusto, it was like I just lit it once and really didn't even have to touch it up. Loved the Neanderthal blend, and it gets a Chuck Norris rating here. This is a this is a really good cigar. Mark, if you smoked that, you remember you were smoking those Saga short tails?
Yes, I do.
You're talking that level. You're talking that level of strength with this.
Wow, holy smokes! Yeah.
Mark, does Paul have any of these in his humidor?
I think he does.
It's ooh, a couple okay. Left.
Yeah, we'll really strong cigars.
After this segment, I know what I'm looking for.
Yeah, I mean, Joe, just make a tray up for yourself and take it home. Yeah.
Do you want me to go next since I have? I actually have 6 cigars.
Go for it.
So if you want me to go for next.
Yeah, you have more than me, so go ahead.
Yeah, okay. Jump into it.
I'm going to start with something from the beginning. It's kind of simple. The 724 Hustler. I smoked the Robusto mainly because I'm a beginning smoker and I don't know what wrapper to look at and what to know, what to actually smoke because I'm not big into the field and I don't know what's good and what isn't. So yes, except for the Brazilians. So I actually smoked this cigar and it was full, and let me tell you.
It's full. It's a full cigar.
Yeah.
That's a Baba pole, correct?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
But it's got some kick. It's got some kick to it.
It was the colors that got my attention first off. But everyone knows pretty colors means one hell of a poison. This cigar it made me queasy. I even ate before it. But unlike the short tails, I think this Hustler was stronger than that. I honestly think it,
really?
Think it was. Yeah. And I gave it a fiver, so.
Okay. Must have had some age on it.
Yeah,
for sure.
It was good. Yeah, it was pretty good.
Now, because here's the thing. People have told me this is not a strong cigar, and I've disagreed with them on that vehemently, saying this thing is got some kick to it. I don't know if I don't know if it's in that short tails, but everyone's palate's different, so I'm not questioning that. But then, if people tell me this is medium, this cigar, no.
No.
No. Yeah.
I think, I think I actually told you about this one.
I think we talked off air on this one.
You were the only one other than me that agreed this cigar is a full cigar.
Yeah, right. Other people probably said that. No, I agree with you on that. Yeah.
You agree too, Joe?
Yeah. So some of the stuff that Kurt has is tends to run a little stronger too. I think even his regular 724 stuff is pretty strong. And a couple years back when I had a chance to meet him, maybe about 5 years ago, I've had a chance to let some age just because I had a bunch of cigars and the 724 is one of those blends that when it ages, I think it does get stronger for sure.
Yep. Mm.
You know, definitely. And the Baba Pull. I like it. I like Baba Pulls. You know, I always try to check them out. It's neat. I think my experience with that particular cigar is there was a shift as you got towards the different leaf stuff, though. It wasn't consistently the same on the palate. It kind of shifted as it went through the Baba Pull segment or however you want to phrase that for sure. But it is a full. It is full.
Yeah, definitely.
Yep. It made you queasy.
Yeah, it did. Just like the Saga Tales. It's the legendary story of Paul came in with the Saga Tales. It comes in a nice box. It's like a book, and it's got like pages before it, and then the last page is the thing and the cigars in there. And he said, first one to get sick loses. And me and another production crew member, we smoked the first two, and Paul left. And we came in here and set down some of the set. Mm-hmm. And we both looked at each other and we were like quarter of the way down. I'm really, I can't see straight.
Right.
I had one of those that like, so here's the thing. So the Saga, right? And we got to see if we have some of those around for Joe to try. But I do a lot of reviews in the morning, right? Now, everyone says they come out with a strong cigar. Most of the time, it doesn't. It's not usually the case. Mm-hmm. I went and smoked that cigar 5 in the morning, and that was a big mistake. That was a big mistake. Okay, this thing really is that strong. So,
what were you doing at 5 in the morning?
Because I wanted to have a cigar before I went in the office, and okay. I was going in the office earlier. Yep.
Yeah, it's one of those, you know you get a long office day, and you want to get a cigar in, and because no matter how your day goes, you've had your cigar.
I read the news, you know, I kind of read a little news beforehand. It's kind of, no one's up in my house, so sometimes I'll do a review, you know, smoke for a review at 5 in the morning. But, so it just happened, I was up. But it was a big mistake. Do not try that at home.
Yeah. Presentation of the hustler, love it.
Love it.
It's got the old school guy with the umbrella, and he's selling stuff out of the briefcase, and presentation's amazing on that, you know?
Yeah, in general, Kurt's presentation, because he's a nostalgia fiend, this guy.
He loves antique trucks and tattoos.
Yep. So I agree. But yeah, that's all about him, and he did a great job on that.
Yeah, he did, for sure.
Yep.
What's the other one you got?
Oh, you want me to keep going?
Yeah, well, okay. You can do two, and then we'll bounce back to Will, and I'll give one. Yep.
The next one I smoked is the PDR 1878, the Especial Capa Maduro.
Okay.
The black label?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And I like pigtail cigars, and this one blew me away.
Okay.
I loved this cigar. The draw, the light, and taste are the base factors of a great cigar, and this had it all. Everything. It smoked. I try to get the palate flavors I'm trying to get used to it more of. I would say it smoked like a fresh autumn. It's got that right when you wake up and you get this nice taste, fresh, cool taste, when the woody aftertaste. It was amazing, and we got a 5-pack. And I rated it a fight Chuck Norris. I really liked the cigar.
Okay.
What size? What size did you have?
The 7x54.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Because that blend, I've liked it better in some sizes, better than others, and I tend to like that in the Robusto. And like the 6x60, I did not like it at all. But so that's a little bit of a bigger ring, and I can't remember if I've ever smoked a 7x54 at though. But other than usually that cigar smoked better in the smaller ring gauge.
Yeah, I don't know. It was a pretty large cigar, and I really, really liked it.
It sells very well down here, that cigar. So it is a very popular cigar, at least in the Carolinas.
Yeah, PDR does do well in the retail. From a PDR perspective, I'm not a Connecticut guy. I've had the white label PDR, Connecticut. Right, it's white. It's natural.
Yeah.
It tastes amazing. Like
it's
mild.
Yeah, I love that. I love that white label.
Yeah,
so I'm with you on that.
It's mild. Great in the morning. I would choose that at 5 in the morning if I was even up at 5 in the morning. Right. But it's one of those things where I've actually, that from a Connecticut perspective, that was one cigar last year that, again, I had it and I was like, wow, I'm pretty impressed. I went back the next day and had it again, the natural, but it's really mild, but
it's very
it's very mild, but it's tasty.
Of the Kappa, those 1878, that Kappa natural is my favorite of the four, the white label. I agree.
Mine too.
I'm on board with that. Yeah.
Yep. For sure.
What do you guys think of the one with the red label? I don't know what that one is. I just know there's white, red, and a black label. Correct?
And there's a blue. And there's a blue.
The blue label.
The red label is my least favorite of the four.
Yeah.
But not a bad cigar. I like the blue. The blue label is very good. It's a Habano. It's really nice.
Yeah. But out of those, the white label is. Mm. Yeah. But I'm gonna go. Yeah. I'm gonna try yours.
Okay. Should try it. It's really, really good.
Yeah.
I really liked it.
Yeah. I'm gonna try yours. Paul gave me the Ernesto Humidor Number 1 Edición Maduro 2015.
Oh, yeah.
That's because he wants all the Connecticuts for himself. No, but it's a very good cigar, I want to hear what you thought about it. I do like that Maduro.
Well, I'm going to give you a little bit of a background, right?
Okay.
Had a chance to smoke that during the inauguration, right? And, you know, I was watching the festivities there. It was mid afternoon on Friday, and, you know, had a chance. It was late morning, and, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, I actually had it, and it was nice, because the image I have in my head is, you know, all the swearing in and the helicopter and the military and all that stuff. But it was one of those cigars that I stopped and I says, this is really a good cigar. I found it to be a medium cigar. I put the review over on the Stogie Geeks website under the StogieGeeks.com over the Stogie section. And I did rate it. I'm trying to think what I rated it off the top of my head. Oh, I rated it a box split with a friend. And the reason for that is because I think the way they come, they only come in three different sets, and you can only buy it in a box set, or you can just buy the packs. Is that correct, Will?
Yeah, you buy the – from what Paul told me, like, obviously the humidor comes with all three blends.
Correct.
And then you can buy refills.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, yeah. I don't know if they're still selling the refills. That's the part I'm not 100% sure of. But, yeah, that's correct.
Yeah, I know Paul bought a box, and we've been digging through that. But he's been saving the Connecticut's for himself.
He likes – and honestly, Paul – it's very good. I like the Maduro better than the Connecticut. So I think you got to bet – but the Connecticut's a very good cigar. He really digs that cigar.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. He turned me onto those as well.
At the end, I gave it medium body, smooth. It's got some sweet notes in it, even though it's medium body. And it's one of those cigars, it stopped me in my tracks. You know, it was one of those things, like, I'm like, wow, this is it's a good cigar. You know, it gathered my attention. And if you ever want to sit down with a friend and catch up on some old times, definitely seek out this cigar for sure.
Yeah, yeah. It's a good. I like it a lot.
Which one did you say it was?
It was
the Connecticut.
Nope, it was the Maduro. The Maduro.
Okay.
Paul has them. Yep. I know exactly where they are. If you want me to get you one.
No, I won't take from that box.
Paul's gonna be like, "Wow, this show is costing me a lot." All right.
Yeah, yeah.
What did you have, Will?
All right. I smoked a Padron Siri 1926 TAA Maduro, and I had smoked the natural a couple of weeks ago of the TAA. So that's a 5.5x60 version of the Padron 1926. And, you know, when I smoked the natural, I gave it a try one. The Maduro I found to be much better in this blend. In fact, I found it significantly better. Here's the thing that surprised me. This Maduro for Padron had some firepower to it. I was a little surprised that these cigars, these were in a medium to full strength, and these were full-bodied smokes, which I wasn't expecting from, because the natural was much more dialed back, but this one seemed to have a little more oomph to it, which I liked. And these have been aging in my humidor for about 8 months. So these, I had bought these back in April, yeah. So I've had these sitting a while. It's got, you know, great balance of sweetness and spice with it. Some nice those cocoa notes in there. There's some cedar notes in there as well. It's a $20 cigar. I liked it enough to go up to a fiver with that one.
Okay.
I liked it. Much better. There's always Joe, on the show, we'll always debate, is it natural or Maduro versus the Padron? And it seems like every size and every blend where Paul and I will differ, or we will agree, but it's never consistent. And this one, I think the Maduro in that 60 ring gauge here is really good.
Yep. And that's big for you, the 60 ring gauge, no? You normally, you said you're...
I will smoke a 60.
Okay.
If it's a good blend.
Yep.
Given that these are the TAA cigars that go to the TAA retailers, I always seek out the TAA cigars. So I tend to buy every one of the releases they have.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if I would have bought this had it come out regular.
Okay. I think Christoph had one about a year ago or 2 years ago. Am I correct?
Yeah.
Or was that, okay.
The classic. Yeah. The classic Reserve. Yeah. That was a good cigar.
That was a very good cigar. And it's one of those things. It's like, why can't they put that on the shelf? Like, I don't.
I totally agree.
Put that on the shelf. That's a especially for Christoph. You know, they're pivoted where, you know, they were with the boutiques, and they started the boutiques, and they're going on, and then, you know, they came up with the pissed off right at the pissed off Christoph. it's a good smoke too. You know what I mean?
It's a good smoke. Very good smoke.
Yeah, but it's one of those things. But that TAA, I was like, what? Can you bring this to market? Like, what's the purpose of that TAA?
Well, what they do is, so the TAA, it's an organization. It really, they're a bunch of like the bigger retailers, and they basically, it's for
the retailers who push out the biggest volume. Is that correct?
It's for ones who push out biggest volume.
Sure.
They don't really set any, like, they're not a policy. Like, people saying, how come the TAA ain't fighting the FDA? No, they're not that. They're ones with bigger volume, so they share some best practices. They have a convention once a year. And then what they do is they get a bunch of manufacturers to offer them exclusive cigars, and they agree to buy a certain volume of those things.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's really the attraction. Now, what's happened is it used to be a very competitive thing. There'd be one or two manufacturers who would land the TAA blend. But in the last few years, they've opened it up. So now there's about 10 or 11 cigars introduced a year for like 1 year. Mm-hmm. They're a plenty of limited release. And I think there's too many of them right now has been the problem. And I kind of would like to go, because I think when there were less of them, you would get you got less new cigars, but you would get a really, really good one back then. So now it's kind of gotten diluted, I think.
Right. Well, when you have more to choose from, naturally that could be the process.
Yeah, but there is a TAA retailer in Rhode Island.
There is?
Yeah. Okay. So I'll have to remember the name of it, but I know Paul doesn't get up there that often because most of the time I'm the one who gets the TAA sticks, but I think it's – I don't want to – I'll look at it off the air.
Okay.
And remember what it is.
Okay.
Because there are some fun sticks they release for the TAA. There's some different things you'll get. Some are better than others. So this was a good one, though.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely.
I can do Will, how many do you have left?
That's okay.
I got like two more, so yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I can do I can skip some cuz
no, they're good.
Oh, go ahead. Okay. Go ahead.
Oh, we're good.
Okay. Yep. I smoked the Edgar Hoill one shot one kill, the Lancero with the pigtail.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you like pigtails? What's this?
I don't know. Yeah. I try to go
you're not a sucker to market it. No. Right? cuz I have some friends that are, you know.
No, I like different looking cigars. I can smoke a cigar it's a Maduro or I like the ones with the closed foots.
Mm-hmm.
I like the ones with the pigtails. I like the barber wrappers.
The barber pole. Yep.
Yeah, the barber pole. And I like looking at cigars more of in the art field.
Mm-hmm.
That's my background is in design. So all the cool wrappers attract me. This Edgar Hoyle has a really, really cool wrapper. But for some reason, I smoke cigars that make me dizzy. So right from the
I like this kid.
Right from the closed foot, I was already dizzy. Like I smoked maybe three or four, and it hit me right away. It actually comes. I didn't know it. I don't know what a pyramid cigar is actually.
It's almost like a torpedo. It's literally like a pyramid. It tapers almost the whole length.
Oh, because it comes in five, a Corona, a Gordo, Lancero, Pyramid, and a Salamone.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a Nicaraguan wrapper, and it's from Honduras, and I rated it as a try one, because I think it's one of those cigars that I never see anyone smoking. I don't know if it's a really popular cigar, but I'd say go try one. It's really good. It was strong.
I didn't find it, so I found it more medium. Medium to full is where I found it.
Mm.
It's stronger than the EH. His other brand is EH. The Osox are definitely stronger.
Mm.
I don't know what the future is of Edgar's brand. I'm going to be honest right now. I was CLE Cigars distributes them, and they seemed a little noncommittal from the people I talked to. I don't think they've pulled it, but I don't know how well the brand's doing either. But he's got some very artesian. His artesian mm-hmm. packaging is amazing on the boxes.
Oh, I didn't see any of the boxes. I only saw I don't know any of the other ones that he has.
There's some stuff on Cigar-Coop from 2015 trade show with it. Yeah, but he's got some. He's a photographer by trade, too, that he kind of got into the cigar business a few years ago.
Oh. I'll have to look, kind of like Drew Estate with their very exotic cigars and their flavors and whatnot.
Yeah. I mean, some of Edgar's stuff's been better than others. I just, like I said, it seemed like they were a little noncommittal. what they're going to do with that brand with CLE right now. So that's, yeah, I don't think I'm telling any trade secret here either. So, yeah.
Were they just not into it or just?
Well, you know, again, I think FDA, they got to figure out what they're going to keep or whatnot. So.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's what it's coming down to. I can't say how well the cigars sell or not. That I can't say.
Yeah.
I'm still optimistic about this FDA. I really am. Especially with the current administration, I think I'm very optimistic. I was always optimistic, even when I was interviewing Mike Bellady for my show about a year ago, and all this was going down, and you know we only got 8 more months, and I says I really think that it's gonna come around, and you know because it again it's being lumped in with other products, and it's just a natural product.
I think our best hope, but I think I've said it, is we go to the administration and we get the blow softened. I don't think the regulations are going away though.
Really?
But I think, yeah, I don't think they go away. But I think that if they put a new FDA commissioner in, if Tom Price gets the HHS nod, and Trump keeps true to deregulating, the problem is there is such a strong anti-tobacco push that's going to happen over this battle that Trump said something today about talking about reducing 75% of the regulations. I heard this could be something that ends up in that 25%. And the only reason why is we just don't have a lot of wins. So that's why I'm a little more negative. I think that the blow will be softened. That's what I do think will happen. I don't think we're going to take the full brunt of it, but we're going to be regulated is my feeling. I hope I'm wrong, and you're right, Joe.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Or they can just postpone it for a couple of years, you know?
that's a big thing that could happen. Right. Because here's what happens, Joe, that they put the regulations out last year, and basically what they do, they take a whole bunch of stuff and they throw it at the wall, right?
Right.
And they say, we'll figure out the devil of the details right later on, okay? Now, there are some regulations out there, but there's some stuff they haven't iterated through yet. So now this stuff that's iterated through with Trump's regulation freeze, they can't do anything more with that right now until they lift that. Mm-hmm. So it's going to slow the wheels of progress. It's probably going to change some of the dates. That was a good thing that happened for the cigar industry last Friday. Mm-hmm. It really was. So I think the delays will help.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Give us another one.
Okay, I'm going to skip to one of these cigars that I had in the beginning this year to start the year off as my palate develops. I had the 6x46 Padron Series 1926 90th Anniversary Tubo.
Mm.
This cigar was phenomenal. I never understood what a woody cigar actually tasted like until I smoked the cigar. I was smoking it. Sometimes I'd forget I even was smoking it. And then I would go down to take another puff, and it was gone.
Mm-hmm.
And if they weren't so expensive, I'd keep buying them on my own. but Paul bought the box with five cigars in there, and the flavor was really there. It wasn't another tobacco tasting cigar to me. If you want anything like this from Padron, this is probably, I'd say, their number one cigar that I've had so far in my collection of cigars.
Yeah.
So I actually rated it a fight Chuck Norris. I had the Churchill. It was full, but I had eaten beforehand, so I wanted to make sure I got the full experience so I didn't get dizzy.
So it didn't make you dizzy?
No. No, I really, Will, Joe, I really like the cigar, and if you haven't had one, you need to have one.
This is the one we just talked about that got number five.
Yeah, you guys were talking about
that. Yeah, it's a good smoke. But like I said, what was the word you'd staple? Padron's a staple. They're a staple in the industry.
Holding it together, yeah.
Mark, definitely what I would use is that is a gateway cigar to Padron. And I would look at possibly trying some of the Family Reserve stuff. It's a little pricier. Okay. But that's some of that best stuff, too. And then you may want to try a 1964 natural just to see how that goes as well. And just a regular 1926, which is box pressed. So I think that's a good gateway. It's a pricey cigar for a gateway cigar to introduce you into a brand. However, I think we're in agreement. It's a solid cigar.
Yes, it was. It burned all the way through. It was something I would smoke again and again. And if you run out of things that are trustworthy, you know you can just go to the these tubos. They're amazing.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know if Paul's going to be in the office, though. Yeah.
No, I know.
Paul's going to have nothing in the office when he comes back to work tomorrow. Right? We're going to, you know.
He's like, I'm ready to kill me.
He's on his way here now to put a hot posh on that. Right,
right, right, right, right, right.
He's on the bus.
I see in the chat, I'm on my way.
Right.
No, I know.
Is that what he just said? Is that what he just said? Right. I talked about this just right quick on the last segment on the top 25. I actually had the opportunity to have the Padron Damaso number 12. And again, excellent cigar, well constructed. If you're looking for that Padron-esque flavor, it's just barely there. But it's a very good cigar. I rated it a try one, you know, especially, you know, if Padron is one of your go-tos and you want to try something different from Padron. Very interesting, Will, within the industry, I found out that over the past couple of years, I noticed that some of the, and again, word of the day is staple, some of the cigars that are known for their staple, like even though Romeo and Julieta, then they came up with that Nicaraguan blend. You know what I mean?
Yep.
So a lot of these classic facings are taking their what they're known for and trying to get into other blends. I think that's hats off to the boutiques for really keeping the classic facings really on their toes.
Great point, Joe. That's a great point. Yeah.
You know, you can just tell that when a new kid on the block shows up to an industry and makes enough impact, imitation is the best form of flattery. You know what I mean? So when Padron starts changing their blends to compete in a market that they're not known for with the Connecticuts, it's pretty hats off to them for sure.
Wow.
I'm in agreement. That's a really good point. Yeah, I mean, because you see these big companies, like Padron hasn't used the word, they got to get more boutique, but I've heard some other big companies say we have to get more boutique. I've heard Drew Estate use that term. I've heard, you know, Altadis kind of use that term, you know, general. So you're right. I think they've definitely felt the boutique presence, and it's had to make them change the game. You're 100% right.
Yeah. I'm trying to find some of the classic facings that actually changed some of the newer blends of the classic facings. That's kind of been my kind of go-to this year, you know, trying to find that. There's not a lot of them, but I bet you if we dig, there's probably at least 10 or 15 or 20.
Yeah, Altadis went through an exercise on that the last few years with the Romeo. Then they did an H. Upman, the Legacy.
Mm-hmm.
They did a couple of Monte Cristos out of Nicaragua. So they've, I think, done it to some extent. General's starting to do it as well. They just announced the Punch Grand Cru Nicaragua. So you start, they're out there.
Yeah,
they're out there.
I mean, it keeps the classic facings on their toes.
Yeah,
you know,
it does.
And it just tells you. I read an article about a year ago how you know how we all fight for a piece of the pie. So say the classic facings makes up 74% of the market. Now it might be 67% of the market, and the retail consumers, us consumers, are really flocking towards these newer brands.
Yeah. And you look at, for example, General's a great example. They just came out with this Grand Cru Nicaragua. So they have this fantastic blend that they've made, and they have, what are they going to call it? Do they come up with a new name? Or do they say, all right, let's look at one of our tried and true brands. It's a staple, again, the word.
Yep.
And maybe we extend that to put that Nicaraguan blend into this line because we think it fits.
Right.
And now you reach those consumers who are familiar with that Grand Cru. Oh, you got a Nicaragua. Yeah, that's something I'll try. As opposed to the unknown brand, which no one is going to hear about.
Right.
So it is a very smart move.
Right. What else did you try?
I actually have one more.
Okay.
Good.
It's actually funny.
Did it make you dizzy?
No, it didn't.
Okay, good.
Okay, good.
It's actually funny. You guys were You actually talked about the Maduro. I smoked the Ernesto's Humidor No. 1 Edition Connecticut 2015.
Paul gave one up.
I was there. I was there when they found the box. They were digging through the humidor.
Paul lost the box of that.
Yeah, they were
the Connecticut.
They were looking for in the cigar club next door. Yeah, in the store.
Okay. I thought it was in the humidor. Okay. No, I can see him doing that. I can see him ripping apart the Havana Club looking for one. Yeah.
Yeah, I was there helping him dig through the humidor next door, and he found it, and it was a 6x54 medium Toro Ecuadorian Connecticut wrapper, and you'd be surprised with this. I gave it a fiver. It wasn't something that really, really shocked me. I'm always looking for cigars that have a different flavor, something different, like kind of like you said with Padron. Mm-hmm. They made this boutique cigar and blew everyone away because it's a different feel than what they're usually making, and this just kind of just was a cigar to me. It had a clean burn all the way through. It created a really heavy smoke, and I like this smoke. It's a good hidden factor to a cigar for me. But in the beginning, it was very strange. I got this popcorn buttery taste when I was smoking it, and I wasn't eating anything while I was smoking it. It was very strange, and it only happened in the first quarter of the cigar, but it lost its lust, as I would kind of like to say. It had components of a great cigar, but it wasn't significant lasting taste or capturing element that would push cigar from a fiver to a box worthy. For me, it was a good smoke if you're just hanging out with someone or you're at a convention where everyone's hanging out and smoking. It's just something that you would smoke, and you can trust that it'll smoke all the way through. You don't have to worry about it canoeing or going out, because I put it down doing some work, and I pick it back up, and it was still lit and still, as I like to say, it's still cherried. So, but other than that, it was a good cigar. It's just nothing that blew me. It wasn't something that surprised me as a right. Some box that Paul was digging for and find this artifact in the humidor somewhere. It was okay.
Okay.
So I had it as a fiver. I thought it was a good cigar, and I agree it had that buttery popcorn note, which I've actually gotten off the Room 101 Connecticut's when they used to be out. But if I had bought a box of those with the three blends, I'd trade Paul the Connecticut's for the Maduros.
Yeah, for sure. Mm. Yeah, for sure.
I think he'd make that deal in a heartbeat.
Yep.
So
there you go.
So I think it'll be a win-win for both of us.
What else did you smoke, Will?
So I smoked the Davidoff Escurio in the Grand Perfecto size, and that was a line extension that they've introduced to the Escurio blend, which is their Brazilian base blend. It's not an all Brazilian blend. And Paul and I've had, I think, mixed experiences with the Escurios. I think there's certain sizes that have been better than others. And for me, it was the Robusto, and I think it was probably for Paul as well. They weren't, but the other sizes didn't quite do it. You know, the Escurios are kind of – they kind of try to bring this balance of sweetness and spice, which I think it does in the first half. But I smoked a couple of these Grand Perfectos, and they're thicker Perfectos. Each time I smoked them, they got real pungent and harsh in the second half. So they kind of went from that sweet – that nice balance of sweetness and spice in the first half, and then they got pungent in the second half. And you know, for me, it probably would have been – they start off great. This could have been a box split to start, but by the end, I had it as a try one at the price it was. It wasn't a cheap cigar. I'd go back each time. You know, if I'm spending my money on an Escurio, I'm gonna go back and buy that Robusto every time over this one.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Yeah, Davidoff. Yeah. They're amazing.
There are. I mean, it's a case where a blend may work in a size better than another. So.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
You were smoking a Davidoff, weren't you, Joe?
No. Well, I was in the second segment. Now I'm on to that. I mentioned in the other segment the Tabernacle, and the guy came in and threw it at me.
Oh, yeah, Pete.
That's a strong cigar.
Yeah, I'm.
You want to talk about? I want to see Mark smoke that because that will get him dizzy. That's not a faint cigar.
Yeah, I'm digging this cigar. You know what I mean? I'm digging this one. I want to go back and have it when I'm not a couple cigars deep. You know,
that I would agree with.
But Monday nights tend me to have be a couple of cigars and drinks deep over here over at Stogie Geeks. You know, so Mondays see when you're 40 change. Monday's the new Friday. Monday, on Stogie Geeks. You know, Friday I had like two Guinness and I was watching the Dukes of Hazzard old stuff.
Oh, yeah,
I was watching the Dukes of Hazzard old stuff at 8 o'clock at night, and now it's what, 9 change, and I'm a couple of cigars deep.
Another weekend.
This is new Friday, right? what day is today? I will tell you, from co-host and Stogie Geeks, my Tuesday morning started at 10. 10 in the morning.
We used to do this thing till 11:30 at night.
Really?
Yeah. In fairness, Paul really said, we can't do this anymore. Right? And he's got like small kids, right? On top of that, right?
Right, right.
So we moved it up, and I got to say, it's better, is all I'll tell you.
Yeah, we used to, when I first started here, we would do the other podcast, and then it would end around, hopefully it would end around, what was it, Will? 7, 8 o'clock, hopefully. And we would go Stogie Geeks after, and Paul would be burnt out, and he'd have to go and take care of his kids. And it's way better now that we have them separate days.
Right.
Monday's the best day to start off the week with the
Monday makes a long day for me, I like it, like it. Today was one of those days I got up really early. It wasn't 5, but it was 6:15 I got up. I got up I'm happy. It's lighty out at 6:15 now. It's not dark out at 5, so I'm excited about that, I had a cigar today. I had the Esteban Carrera's Chupacabra before, and I got reacquainted with this today over next door, about a couple hours before the show. I had the Chupacabra, which it's named after a fictional character.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. But I had the Hellcat, and
I love that cigar.
Yes, I had the box press Hellcat. I got the wrapper here. This is one of those cigars. I took a picture of it. I was ready to start. I was all alone next door, and then people started walking in. And so I really didn't get a chance to think about the rest of the cigar when I had it. So I'm going to have it probably Wednesday again. If my schedule, Wednesday's my birthday, so I'm gonna have this for my birthday in the morning. I'm looking forward to this. Ooh.
Joe, and I think that's a cigar. It's different than the Chupacabras. I think they just put it under that line again, kind of a tried and true thing. It's a box press San Andreas.
Yep,
and I really enjoyed that cigar.
Yeah, like I said, like from a social perspective, actually it's pigtailed. First of all,
oh, look at that. Maybe I should try one.
You should try one. It's right next door. Right, it's in that $9 price point. It's a great cigar. I had the Toro size, but I took the picture. I was ready to stop blogging, and then people walked in, and then away it goes. So it will be up on the Stogie Geeks website over this week. If everything goes to plan, it'll be on my birthday. Take a selfie too.
Yeah, come on in.
There
maybe
you go.
We'll get it. Maybe we'll buy it for you.
Yeah, it was good. But it's one of those things where, again, I have to go back to it because, a couple of friends started walking in, and then another friend, and next thing you know, we're 5 guys deep, and away the cigar went,
Yeah.
It was a good time.
Absolutely.
So, Will, do you have any more cigars?
I am cigared out. Now, just a word of to kind of let you guys, I won't be here next week because I'm going to the Dominican Republic, which I've never been. So I'm going to have a lot of cigars the week after. So it's going to be a lot of smoke because I'm doing a couple of days in Miami before I go down there. So
I love Miami.
Oh, me too.
I love Miami. It's
I don't want to live there. I don't want to live there, but I love going there.
Right.
Only been in the airport.
No, you got to go to Miami.
Been the airport.
How old are you? 20?
24.
Oh, you would rip it up in Miami.
Oh,
you
would rip it up. 20,
a 24-year-old Italian kid in Miami, dude, you rip it up like me, man. I'm telling you.
Oh, you'd be.
And I'm Brazilian. I love the sun, so let's do this.
It'd be a good time for sure.
Yeah.
So we're going to miss you next week.
No, but you're in good hands, and then I'll be back the week after. I'll kind of give you my my tales
analysis.
And, All
right. Well, I wish you safe travels.
Thank you.
Looking forward to, that, Will.
Take pictures.
I've never been to the DR. Yeah, I've never been to the DR, so it'll be a lot of pictures. Yep.
Yeah, make sure you take pictures and post them on social so we can follow you for sure.
We'll get you guys some goodies too. So
awesome.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm gonna go dig through Paul's humidor for sure.
Oh yeah.
Yep. Yeah, just help. Yeah. Help yourself.
Oh, I am. Don't you worry. I'm not shy.
You're in his seat.
But I will tell you, this seat, I'm Paul. I don't know. I really like this seat. It's a good seat.
Seat is a good seat. You did good in the seat, Joe. Yeah, you did very good in the seat.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, appreciate it. Yeah.
All righty.
All right.
Anything else to say? You good?
No, I got through all my cigars.
All right.
We're good.
We keep the conversation going all week long. Make sure you go on the website, stogiegeeks.com, cigar-coop.com. Thank you for tuning in.